enter at your own risk. Inside France's no-go zones.
This is like another country inside France, yeah?
Yeah.
Plus, the trainer to the stars, Jimmy Pena, shares the weight loss plan that'll put your faith to the test. And
my whole face was swollen.
A cry for help.
And I said, God, do something.
And an answer to prayer.
I want to see God do that for everybody, what he did for me.
It's the 700 Club. Thank you so much for being with us. We've got some tremendous testimonies for you today. A dramatic, extraordinary healing. And you can be part of that prayer time on the 700 Club. By the way, when there was something called the Federal Election Commission, and there was a lady named Lois Lerner who was an official in that organization. And I know, because I was at the center of some of their wrath. They went after Christians. They went after conservatives. They did all kinds of things. And then Lois Lerner moved from the FEC over to the tax-exempt branch, where I think she was the director of that very important part of the Internal Revenue Service. And she's been caught doing some nasty things to conservatives. And she is now the center of the Tea Party scandal, and she actually could find herself facing criminal charges. Congressional investigators say they have evidence against her that might lead to jail time. Mm-hmm.
That move came as another committee is set to hold her with contempt of Congress. Heather Sells has that story.
The House Ways and Means Committee voted to refer Lois Lerner's case to the Justice Department for prosecution, saying she violated the rights of conservative groups and misled investigators. Lerner has denied any wrongdoing.
I have not done anything wrong.
Lerner was head of the IRS tax-exempt division when the agency targeted Tea Party and conservative groups who were trying to gain tax-exempt status.
The chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee says Lerner specifically targeted Crossroads GPS. That's a political nonprofit founded by GOP strategist Karl Rove. Chairman David Camp says Lerner tried to have the application denied.
Former IRS agents told congressional investigators that liberal groups were not targeted in the same way.
This wasn't an equal opportunity discrimination. This was targeted discrimination coming from the Internal Revenue Service. And what I'd like to address now is that our view is that that determination came from the highest ranks of the Internal Revenue Service.
The House committee says Lerner violated federal law in three ways: using her position to improperly influence agency action against conservative groups, impeding official investigations by providing misleading statements, and risking confidential taxpayer information by using her personal email to conduct official business.
I think that the IRS is going to do everything it can to silence anybody in America who wants to talk about how elected officials voted on Obamacare. I actually believe that that is the fundamental reason for all of this effort.
Lawyers for the conservative groups believe politics is behind Lerner's actions, and Democrats say Republicans are being partisan by pressing for charges against Lerner. Wednesday's vote to refer her case to the Department of Justice reflects the divide. All Republicans voted in favor, and all Democrats voted against. Heather Sells, CBN News.
I'm a Christian. I don't believe in karma, but a lot of people do. And the whole thought is what goes around comes around. And so karma's getting ready to bite Lois Lerner pretty heavy. She thought she could get away with it, and maybe she is. You know, she's on suspension for taking the fifth, but she's still getting a full government salary. So what's the consequence? What's the downside? Well, something's coming around to get her. Well, in other news, why did he do it? Why did a 16-year-old boy stab more than 20 people at a Pennsylvania high school? John Jessup has more on that story from our news bureau.
That Pennsylvania high school pad is closed today following Wednesday's stabbing spree. The suspect, 16-year-old Alex Reibel, faces four counts of attempted homicide and 21 counts of aggravated assault. His father says he's praying for the victims.
My prayers go out to everyone who is injured today, and I hope they recover as quickly as possible.
He's a typical young kid. He's a B-plus student. It's the families like Ozzie and Harriet. They have dinner together every night. I mean, they did not see this coming.
Last night, there were prayer vigils and tears in the suburban Pittsburgh community. Many students and faculty at Franklin Regional High School are being called heroes. One student pulled the fire alarm to alert everyone in the building, but that didn't stop 21 students and a security guard from getting injured. The incident did not end until the assistant principal tackled the suspect.
Bring healing to our region.
Here again, we're witnessing young people being hurt, and I just feel very strongly that we need to address the underlying issues.
Prosecutors say Rybel will be tried as an adult, and PAD investigators are still trying to determine a motive.
I want data, and I think we are owed a careful investigation of how many of these perpetrators have been on various types of antidepressant medicine, Paxil, Zoloft. I don't know. I don't take any of that stuff, but it's a whole pharmacopoeia, and it's so easy. You have a troubled kid, feed him some pills, get him doped up. I mean, that's the easy way. And you know, why bother with all the hassle? So most from the indication I've seen of these shootings, of these rampages, have been the result of people who have been medically diagnosed and placed on antidepressants. And that's not good. We need to bring that out. And that isn't coming out. It's not being ventilated as it should in the press. John.
Pat, a 9-year-old Tennessee boy gets legal help after being told he couldn't read his Bible during an after-school reading program. And as Caitlin Burke reports, he had an unlikely legal ally.
It's an issue of religious freedom, and 9-year-old Austin Grayson knows his rights.
Free country, free religion.
That was Austin's response when a teacher at his after-school program told him he couldn't read his Bible during quiet time.
And apparently they didn't like that. They saw it to be disrespectful.
Austin's mother says the school told her that her son couldn't read religious material because the after-school program is funded by public money.
I felt like infuriated.
The American Civil Liberties Union stepped in to defend Austin. They sent a letter to the after-school program reading in part, "Tennessee public school students cannot be denied the right to engage in religious activities."
I'm so thankful that the law has been clarified, you know, not only for Reach, but for everyone that the story has touched.
The ACLU letter requests that the after-school program train its employees on their, quote, obligation under the law to protect students' religious liberties. It also asks that Austin be allowed to read his Bible during free time and activity time.
A good ending.
Yeah, we're ever so grateful.
Definitely.
Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Pat, it seems pretty obvious that kids can bring their Bibles with them to schools.
I founded an organization called the National Legal Foundation later on that went into disrepair. I then founded the American Center for Law and Justice. But the National Legal Foundation had a case about a Bible school where the school was prohibiting students from studying and reading the Bible in their free time. And the case was called Westside School District versus Mergens. And the Mergens case went to the Supreme Court, and by a 7-2 decision written by Justice Brennan, the Supreme Court said students do not lose their First Amendment freedoms when they walk through the door house or the school door. And the only thing that they wanted to prohibit was the school imposing its views on students. But students have an absolute freedom to meet, to have Bible study, and of course, but there seems to be in the educational community a small group of teachers who really hate religion. They're dedicated atheists or dedicated agnostics or what have you, and they want to push these rules and say, well, you can't read your Bible, you can't wear a cross, you can't talk about Jesus, you can't hand out tracts. All of that is totally unconstitutional. And imagine now the ACLU is coming out in defense of the students. But the case is a landmark Morgan's versus Westside School District, and it's still on the books. John.
Pat, a growing number of Americans are skeptical of the Bible and consider it the teaching of men rather than the Word of God. About 1 in 5 Americans doubt the Bible's relevance and authority. That's twice as many as the survey found in 2011. The biggest increase came among 18 to 29-year-olds. The results can be found in the 4th annual State of the Bible survey conducted by the Barna Group for the American Bible Society. The society aims to reach more people by sharing the Bible through cell phones and social media. Well, in the past few years, drone technology has changed the landscape of modern military warfare. While most attention has been on deadly airstrikes, the Israeli military is using drones to save lives and win the public relations battle against their enemies. Chris Mitchell brings us the story from Israel.
From the giant Heron drone to the portable Skylark, unmanned aerial vehicles help the Israeli army protect Israelis, their soldiers, and even their enemies.
We have the communication with the ground troops to say them exactly what to do, to talk directly to the forces and to aim them to the right places to go or to fire or to hide if necessary.
This drone video shows the Israeli Air Force calling off an airstrike because Palestinian children are playing soccer by the intended target. Captain N is a drone operator. We've hidden his identity for security reasons.
Probably the most important thing that the UAVs help during combat is to distinguish terrorists from civilians, because most of the enemy techniques here in the region is to operate from civilian areas, because we really don't want to hurt civilians during combat.
The drones also capture all the action on video. That levels the public relations playing ground when Israel's enemies and the international community accuse it of wrongdoing.
We could see very clearly, okay? The Israeli UAVs could see everything you could think that you want to see. And I could distinguish if the man has a red shirt or smoking a cigarette or have sunglasses or a hat.
In 2012, Israel launched Operation Pillar of Defense in response to massive rocket attacks on Israeli citizens from terror groups inside the Gaza Strip. Much of the 8-day battle was directed by and captured on video from drones.
The Arab world and our enemies, they want the world to see that Israel is not moral. Instead of what you hear, the technology that the Israeli army use is being used only for logical and safety measured in combat.
Here we see Palestinian rockets launched at Israel. And here the IDF delays its strike because a motorcycle enters the road. While technology provides eyes and ears, the commanders must still make the decisions. Captain N says morality also comes with a price.
We can't really hit and destroy the targets and the people that we wanna destroy, because we consider the population and the civilians, people around those kind of terrorists.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, the Judean Desert.
Turning to health news, mothers who indulge in junk food while they're pregnant may be programming their unborn babies to want the same kind of bad foods and eventually grow up to be obese themselves. According to news.com.au, researchers at Adelaide University in Australia found that pregnant lab rats who ate the wrong food changed the appetites of their children, which led them to overeat. And it increased their appetites for sugary and fatty foods while also changing their metabolism. The rats who ate junk food were twice as fat as the rats who ate well. And Pat, if only those lab rats were allowed to watch the 700 Club, they'd be much better off.
Exactly right. We'll program lab rats like they've never been programmed. They'll be so healthy and lean and fit, it'll be unbelievable. But you know, you see fat families.
You do.
Fat kids. Why? Because they're all eating the wrong things.
Yeah, it's sad. And those poor rats.
Poor rats.
Pregnant rats being
pregnant
fed
rats
junk food.
Programming their little innocent rat babies. It's just horrible. We must take a stand about that. We must demonstrate. Wendy.
Oh dear. Up next, in some parts of the world, it's dangerous to be white. The people in this video are being attacked because of the color of their skin. Find out where this is happening and why after this.
I was having some pains between my shoulder blades. At that point, everything changed. Diagnosis, pancreatic cancer. First, there was prayer. The second is to fight. As soon as we walked through those doors at Cancer Treatment Centers of America, all my anxiety left. The pastoral care here is based on the Bible, based on the Word of God, just as it is at our own church.
When you combine the great medicine with the spiritual resources we have, it provides the patients with something that really can make a difference.
You got a pastor right there on staff praying with patients, and whether it be scripture or whether it just be a word of encouragement to say, God's got this.
If you or someone you love is fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com/faith. You'll learn how our treatment results compare to national averages and see a list of insurance plans with which we've worked. Advanced medicine and technology, the warm embrace of the Spirit.
I firmly believe God led me here.
Call or go to cancercenter.com. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits. Appointments available now.
Friday.
We know what's coming.
Colorado's pot problem. Why medical marijuana is only the beginning.
Rolling Stone magazine called them the iPod of getting baked.
Plus,
the best route to make money was to deal drugs.
A drug dealer blacks out.
We were in quite the fight.
And wakes up as a murderer.
I had no idea how many times I had stabbed my victim.
On the 700 Club.
Think it can't happen here? Just stay around and see what's happening in France. Imagine feeling threatened walking on the streets of your own city if your skin happens to be white, a pale face. In parts of France, that scenario is all too real. That's because of a growing number of attacks on the native French in territory controlled by those disciples of peace, the Muslims. Dale Hurd brings us this shocking story from Paris.
White French being beaten up by predominantly Muslim immigrant gangs. Violent crime can happen anywhere and to anyone, and for many reasons. But in parts of France, it has become especially dangerous to be white.
There are parts of France where the native French are no longer welcome. Muslim immigrants consider it their territory. And whites enter at their own risk.
The French call them sensitive urban zones. They're no-go zones where the police don't enter or don't enforce the law. They're little Muslim caliphates inside the borders of France.
And it's like that because these parts of the country are in the hands of drug traffickers, gangs, and imams.
This French report says almost one in five Frenchmen have been victims of racist insults or worse. A few cases have even gone to trial.
Some of those who launch racist attacks on whites use Islam as the reason they do it. They may not even speak Arabic, but they still use Islam as a flag.
Tariq Yildiz, a French sociologist, has written the book Anti-White Racism. Yildiz is not native French, but is the son of Turkish immigrants.
My book is viewed as politically incorrect and breaks a taboo. The idea that immigrants could oppress whites.
It's a reality for this Frenchman named Max. He's been attacked more than once by immigrants and still has a bruise under one eye from the latest attack. Max sports an American accent after living in the U.S., but he's French and has joined Generation Identitaire, a youth movement united around the defense of French culture and white French identity.
Well, basically, we're a youth movement that aims to promote, preserve, and protect our local, national, and European identities.
This video shows Generation Identitaire members training for self-defense.
Well, we encourage all our members and militants to keep a certain level of physical fitness. Self-defense is a part of it, obviously.
As the French left's grand experiment in multiculturalism goes up in flames, some quarters of French society are dividing into tribalism and ethnic identity. Pierre Cassin and Christine Tesson are anti-Islamization activists.
The French people are increasingly living in fear. They fear the imposition of Islamic law and the organized violence against any French person, including the police.
More and more Islamists threaten riots, assault, and try to impose Sharia. They attack the police. The Republic is in danger.
This French news report shows Generation Identitaire members out on a security patrol. Yildiz says by ignoring the problem of immigrant attacks on whites, the French establishment and media are only helping to ensure that more whites will seek out groups like Generation Identitaire for protection.
If the state will not punish these people and the media will not talk about it, the victims will get increasingly frustrated and could become racist, and then we will have a confrontation.
Not only is the problem being ignored, the French left and many mayors actively promote the growth and spread of sectarian Islam for good reason. Muslims have become an important constituency of the left. 90% voted for socialist President Hollande in the last election.
La rue Mira, c'est par là, bien.
Merci. Former Muslim Pascal Halut wanted to show us the mosque in the Paris district of Barbès that the mayor's office is paying to renovate. The name of the mosque is in Arabic, so perhaps the French don't realize they're paying to renovate a mosque named Conquest.
So this is like another country inside France, yeah?
Yeah, the liberalization or Balkanization of France is beginning already with the help of the state of France.
Lebanon, it's a word some use to describe France's future as a nation divided and engulfed in sectarian conflict. Hilut believes, as do many experts, that the French left's experiment with Islam is going to backfire badly.
The French feel outnumbered, outmaneuvered, and in the minority. If things continue at this rate, we will have the same situation as in Kosovo or Lebanon, civil war.
Dale Hurd, CBN News, Paris.
Great reporting. I asked if Dale had gone down in one of those bond years, and I was told that his white skin wouldn't really permit it, but he did a great story about it. Hey, listen, we have in our hands right now something that's fantastic. It's called Islam, Religion of Peace or War. You need to have this book. It is just beautifully written. It is analyzed by Arabic-speaking experts on Islam. It has multiple quotes from Muhammad, directly from the Quran. It has historical facts and the story in the appendix of how many hundreds of millions of people have been killed by Muslims in various parts of the world over the years, from all groups, from Hindus, from Indians, Chinese, etc. You need to have this book. We've got 6,500 people, I believe, so far have... No, 16,000, I'm sorry, 16,000 have asked for it. And we'll give it to you free. If you want multiple copies, you might consider a contribution. But it's published by, brought out by the truth. And it's called Islam, Religion of War or Peace. You can get it just by calling up or writing. The number's on your screen, and you can log on to cbn.com. I saw something in the press yesterday that the Wall Street Journal had a comment on today. There's a lady named Hersey Alley who wrote a book called Infidel. Did you ever read that book?
I've heard of it.
All right. Well, she's from Sudan. She's she was brought up as a strict Muslim. And all of a sudden, she began to rebel against it. They do genital mutilation of women. It's really horrible what they do. They have enforced marriage. They have subjugation of women. They have women beaten and so forth. And so Hersey Alley took a stand against it. And they kicked her out of her society, and she went to Europe and ran for parliament, I believe, and was it Belgium where she was elected to parliament. A great spokesperson for human rights, Brandeis University, which is named after Louis Brandeis, that great Supreme Court lawyer and judge. Brandeis University was going to give her an honorary degree, and then they said, well, she's too controversial, we're not going to do it. So they pulled back the invitation to Hersey Alley. Mm. I mean, it's shocking. And so, listen, they intimidate. When they're in the minority, they speak peace. When they get in the majority, they oppress and beat and kill, just like it's happening in France. Islam, you need this book. You need the book to tell what's going on. Whew. Not enough.
We need to be informed.
Well, we really do. I mean, it's so insidious. I mean, it, you know, when I was growing up, I went to college and we talked about jihad. We learned about jihad in college, and all the jihads were militant attacks by Muslims against the Christian populations of North Africa and the Middle East. Now, the Islamics are trying to say, well, jihad really means a struggle against the soul. That is pure bull. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is a struggle to maintain or acquire dominance. And the desire of the Muslim Brotherhood is to reestablish what they call the caliphate, which was the they want the caliphate was located in Baghdad in Iraq, and was that crescent throughout that area. That's what the Muslim Brotherhood wants. And somehow our government, our leaders, they're just like blind or willingly duped.
Well, we got some good news coming up, some fun news.
Let's get fun news. I've been given heavy stuff. Let's get light stuff. Okay.
Coming up, Tyler Perry, Mario Lopez, and LL Cool J. All of these celebrities credit their buff bodies to one trainer. There he is, Jimmy Pena, and he's here to help you get fit. Right after this.
I have a son who's extremely smart and sensitive. He went to heaven. I came back.
One true story has become a worldwide sensation.
You saw heaven?
It's beautiful.
This Easter, Heaven is for Real is a profoundly beautiful movie.
They don't read me, do they?
Some people might be afraid to believe.
That will help many to believe.
Is heaven a hope or as real as the earth and sky?
A perfect family film. Heaven is for Real. Rated PG.
What can that be?
52-year-old male complaining of chest pains.
Clear.
Heart attacks can happen at any time. My name is Dr. Crandall, and as a cardiologist, I tell my patients that they need to be aware of the hidden symptoms of a heart attack. Here's the truth. If you suffer cardiac arrest outside of a hospital, you have just a 7% chance of surviving. That is why I've created the Simple Heart Test, to help you determine your own risk of heart disease. Go online today, and in just 2 minutes, you'll discover your risk of suffering a heart attack, how you score on my heart disease risk factor scale, plus the key warning signs your heart is in trouble. Over 2 million Americans have already taken my Simple Heart Test, and I urge you to do so now, before it's too late.
Take your free online heart test today and discover how to get Dr. Crandall's bestseller, The Simple Heart Cure. Go to simpleharttest.com today.
Well, Jimmy Pena is an exercise physiologist and best-selling author with a list of celebrity clients. He says the key to getting fit is faith. Take a look.
Whether people go on a diet to look better, feel better, or it's just doctor's orders, few recognize the spiritual aspect of healthy eating. That's according to exercise physiologist Jimmy Pena, who teaches that faith and food go hand in hand. In his new book, The Prayfit Diet, Pena shares a revolutionary diet that's based on biblical principles and cutting-edge science. This balanced approach will build your faith and help you lose weight.
All right, he's here, Jimmy Pena. Great to see you.
Thanks for having
me. Nice apron.
You like that?
Thank you. Now, Jimmy, you say that our health is a means of praise. And I like what you said. You have a quote saying, all we need as believers is two things, to be in God's will and to have our health. What do you mean?
God's will and good health. You know, everything at PrayFit, PrayFit.com, is we steep it in grace. We look at our health through the prism of grace. And that puts faith to work. And when we see our health as a means of praise, it changes everything. So those are the things we need, God's will, good health, and that's the gist of the PrayFit Diet.
Beautiful book here, The PrayFit Diet. Jimmy, how does prayer fit into dieting?
Well, like I said, you know, we steep it every single day, quiet times, spending time with the Lord, having our devotion, and then putting our health to work, putting our faith to work, and that includes the food. And it's so interesting. Balance is so key.
And I like that about you, Jimmy, because you don't say get rid of dairy, get rid of wheat. You say balance is the key, and you recommend a diet that's called the Simple 33 Balance. What is the Simple 33 Balance?
Well, yes, balance is absolutely key. Everything about this book is balance. In fact, the science says that when you bring the macronutrients of carbs and proteins and fats in perfect proportion, so many good things happen. Enough protein for healthy muscle, enough carbs for good sustained energy, healthy fats for brain health, heart health, lungs, and our joints. It's really, really beautiful. And we don't cut out food groups. It's an inclusive, embracing kind of meal plan. So it's really beautiful.
Now, you work with a lot of celebrities, and I guess a lot of regular people too. What's it like working with the celebrities? Because they really have to look good. So do you have to be more strict with them?
You know, the whole premise of health and how I approach the writing and the books, I've been really blessed to be on the sets of movies and helping people get ready for projects. But the idea that our health and our food, we're a machine, you know, and whether you're going in front of the camera or, you know, you're helping your neighborhoods. And our main thing now is going into churches all across the country, talking to people about eating healthily, pushing away from the table sooner rather than later, and really, really putting our bodies to use, putting our health to work in our communities.
All right, Jimmy, we've got a full day here of food on your PrayFit plan. Let's start with breakfast.
Yep. Super important. They say it's the most important, and it is, you know. When you wake up, you've had an overnight fast. Right. And on the PrayFit diet, we have so many options in terms of breakfast. Here, this one is beautiful yogurt and berries and flaxseed and walnuts. We have omelets. We've got oatmeal, you know, all sorts of wonderful breakfasts.
Biggest blueberries I've ever seen.
Right.
Look amazing. Can I have one?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, and then for lunch, the sandwich looks delicious.
Yeah. Lunch is a bridge. And, you know, this sandwich is perfect. It's got Ezekiel bread, which is a perfect complex carb.
Can you get that? You have to go to health food stores to get Ezekiel bread.
In fact, it's everywhere now.
Is it everywhere?
Health food stores, normal grocery stores, and it's a great perfect protein.
It's a nice taste too. I really like it.
Good texture, good taste, very, very healthy. And then we move on to you know, all of these meals are just like kindling on a fire, continuing to embrace that metabolism.
Some people might say, you know, where's my chips or where's something? Are you just saying just have the sandwich?
Just the sandwich, absolutely. See, it's not much food, but this is very filling.
But it's fueling you breath. You don't have that sluggish feeling afterwards because you've eaten too much.
No sluggish feeling. The healthy carbs that we have, they really help you feel full, give you that sustained energy so you don't have the lulls in how you feel.
And I love the snack.
The snack, some hummus, wonderful fiber, the carrots, wonderful, wonderful vitamins. And then the dinner is one of my favorites. I chose the chicken Jerusalem for mom. Mom makes a beautiful chicken Jerusalem. This one, we're going to, basically, chicken Jerusalem is a wonderful dish where we've got artichokes. In fact, artichokes are in season right now.
So we've got our chicken.
Yeah, it's kind of sizzling.
Sizzling here in olive oil. So you're going to teach us how to make chicken Jerusalem, Jimmy. What do you need next?
Okay.
We've got our chicken sizzling.
Yeah, okay. So once you've got your chicken seasoned, you know, in some olive oil, some salt and pepper, you can go ahead and start adding in. Why don't you hand me the artichokes?
Okay.
We'll start with some of the main things.
I love artichokes.
Okay. Yeah, throw those in there.
Those are nice, and they're so healthy for you.
And then why don't we throw this stock? And this is some chicken stock.
Yeah, it looks a little dry. We need a little.
Yeah.
We need it. Ooh, that looks
good.
Get this
going. Yes. Let's turn this up a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and then we can add some leeks, and you can play around with this. Sometimes shallots will work. Mm-hmm. Put some garlic in here.
I love garlic. Garlic would be great
some
too.
Some spinach too.
Mm-hmm.
Put some mushrooms,
Put
some mushrooms.
Okay.
And then once this keeps going about, you know, once the chicken is made and it's sauteing really good, then we can add in some of this Greek yogurt here. Now, in a lot of recipes, you'll see heavy cream, but we don't want to use the heavy cream. This, the Greek yogurt makes it really nice and tasty.
How about a little salt and pepper?
Salt and pepper.
All of it? Let's do it.
Throw it in there.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Oh, that's not that much. Yep. And you need a little salt.
A little salt.
Okay.
A little salt, and that's fine. Mix this together about 8 to 12 minutes. We're just making this nice and good, and this gets really, it gets really beautiful. And it doesn't necessarily have to be pretty, but it's delicious.
It's not super colorful, but it smells great. Okay, no.
At the end, we can add some...
This is after it's pretty much done, and you just want to garnish it with the tarragon?
Tarragon, yeah. Mm. The tarragon's going to draw a lot of good flavor out of all of the vegetables. Whatever vegetables you add to this, it's just going to kind of draw it, and the chicken as well.
What's your nationality, Jimmy?
It's really good. I'm Mexican-American.
Okay. This dish would be considered Jerusalem chicken.
That's right. It's not too far away. It's so delicious. It's one of my favorites. In fact, we've had a beautiful end product when it's all said and done.
Okay. And now now we've got our tarragon and we've got our parmesan, and so this would be a typical day
and dinner on the Prayfit plan, which there are so many combinations and wonderful recipes. It's just truly delectable.
Wow. I can't.
We're gonna dig into this later.
It's got a little spice, not spice, but there's some. Maybe it's the artichokes, because very interesting flavor.
Again, mm-hmm. it all gets drawn out, and then you can have a side salad if you'd like, or you can just have it alone. And at the end of the day, you have eaten perfect caloric proportions, protein, fats, and carbs. And research shows that when all of these are in perfect proportion, the body does some wonderful things, reduces inflammation, increases heart health, the brain works better, cognitive function. People learn better when our foods are in balance. No exclusions, embrace the food.
Because for you, all of this is a spiritual experience. And when you train people, it's spiritual.
Well, listen, food should not rule our lives, you know? It should fuel our lives.
That's such Absolutely. A great line. Say that again.
Yeah. Food should not rule our lives. It should fuel our lives. Truly. This is a tool. Our bodies are just vessels. It's all about grace. We're steeped in grace. Mm. And that's the way we should view food.
Grace comes in when we have dessert. Okay. Jimmy's book is called The Prayfit Diet, and it's available wherever books are sold. Jimmy, it's such a pleasure to meet you. God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Well, still ahead, we're going to bring it on with your questions. A viewer wants to know, what does it mean that what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven? I've never found a satisfactory answer. You're about to get one coming up.
Today we're on a field trip to discover what inflation is doing to our paper money. In this hand is a $20 bill, and in this hand is a $20 US gold coin. They used to have the same buying power, but how much can they buy today? In this first basket is what my $20 bill buys: milk, bread, peanut butter, and jelly. And here's what one $20 gold coin will buy: 6 baskets full, worth nearly $2,000, almost 100 times more food, simply by owning gold dollars instead of paper dollars. History shows that the gold coins have been the best way to beat the rising cost of living. So class, the moral is that unless you want to live on peanut butter and jelly sandwiches in the future, you should turn some paper dollars into gold coins now. How and why is explained in a new book,
The Great Withdraw.
Call the number below for a totally free copy. And that's the simple truth.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. An outspoken critic of Islam is accusing Brandeis University of betraying its founding principles by caving to pressure from faculty and students. Brandeis planned to give Ayan Hirsi Ali an honorary degree, but pulled back after complaints. Ali was born in Somalia and raised in a strict Muslim home. She renounced her faith after suffering civil war, genital mutilation, beatings, and an arranged marriage. In 2007, she told Reason magazine, "I think we are at war with Islam, and there's no middle ground in wars." She says Brandeis' reversal is a slur on her reputation, and she is even more deplorable than it when an institution set up based on religious freedom should betray its own founding principles. A Southern California school district will allow students to hand out Bible coins outside class, saying teachers who banned them violated the children's rights of free expression. The San Bernardino Sun reports earlier this year, a teacher banned 4 children from handing out plastic coins with Bible verses during recess. Urged by a nonprofit group, the school district investigated and concluded the teachers had suppressed the children's First Amendment rights. Remember, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website, cbnnews.com. Pat and Wendy will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
a son who's extremely smart and sensitive. He went to heaven. I came back.
One true story has become a worldwide sensation.
You saw heaven?
It's beautiful.
This Easter, Heaven is for Real is a profoundly beautiful movie.
They don't read me, do they?
Some people might be afraid to believe.
That will help many to believe.
Is heaven a hope or as real as the earth and sky?
A perfect family film. Heaven is for Real. Rated PG.
When you get to a certain point in life, you know what you need. And what you don't.
That's why we love Consumer Cellular. Finally, we have a wireless plan that fits us to a T.
Oh, excuse me. Would you sell these separately? I only need two. Oh,
certainly. You shouldn't buy more than you need.
Well, I wish the rest of the world felt that way.
That's why we use Consumer Cellular. You can change your plan anytime to make sure you get the best price for the minutes you use. And they start at just $10 a month.
$10?
Consumer Cellular. Simple plans with award-winning service and no contracts at about half the cost of other carriers. Start your risk-free trial today. Switching couldn't be easier. You can even keep your number, get free activation and free shipping, or pick out your new phone at Sears. Consumer Cellular is the exclusive wireless provider for AARP members. Ask about your special discounts.
Call Consumer Cellular at 1-800-789-5039. Go online at consumercellular.com or visit a Sears store today.
I'm Professor Radisson.
Fill in the papers I've just given you with three little words. God is dead.
I can't do what you want of him, Christian.
God's Not Dead is the movie sweeping across the nation.
What do you say to people who
don't believe?
If we disown him, he'll disown us.
It's a box office winner. God's powerful.
Science supports his existence. You know the truth. Why do you hate God?
See why people are raving about God's Not Dead. Rated PG, now playing.
All right, it's time for your questions, and we're going to get right to it. One viewer writes, what does it mean that what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven? I've never found a satisfactory answer for this. Pat, what is
that? Okay, in the old days, a rabbi could give instructions to people, and they would bind obligations, like you've got to walk a mile, you've got to give tithes, you've got to tithe mint, cumin, and anise, and all that stuff. So the thought of binding obligations is what the rabbis or the rabbinical council would do. All right. So Jesus said to his disciples, whatever you bind on earth, we'll ratify it in heaven. So the Church of God has the privilege, meeting in council, to bind regulations or to take away regulations. They can loose those regulations. And so you find a council discussing the dietary laws, and they said, well, we'll lay no more burdens on these except that you refrain from blood and fornication and so forth. So that's what the Lord gives us the privilege as Christians in concert to bind regulations, loose regulations. That's what it means.
Okay. Okay, interesting. Well, Brian writes, hi, Pat. I am about to receive an inheritance. I am very concerned about what to do with it because of the condition of the world and impending end times. I'm afraid of investing it. I have been forced to retire at 60. So this money has to last until I die. I'm thinking of just cashing in and hope the cash lasts. What are your thoughts on banks or investing during end times, and what are the risks? I live in Canada.
Right. Canada is a good country to be living in. It's probably better than the United States. So you've got a good start. I tell you, I, for one, like investments that somebody said that sweat, that throw off good dividends. And I really like very much master limited partnerships, and I think you have them in Canada. They certainly have them in the United States. These are pipeline companies. These are utilities and so forth, where they, under the law, they must give 85%, depending on the terms. But the majority of their profits have to be passed out as dividends. So some of them pay 6%, 7%, 8%, 9%, 10%. So otherwise, you'll be eating your seed corn, and as you go down through life, that money's not, you don't know how long you're going to live, and you need to have something that's paying dividends. Now, you balance it, you could have five or six of those, and maybe a utility. There's some good companies in Canada. I have done very, very well with Canadian companies, especially those natural resource companies. They're not as good now as they used to be, but I would do that. Some of the cash is good, and you don't want to eat it all up. You can put some cash. I don't know about banks. I'm not too keen about banks, but I like you can get mutual funds. You can get other ways of putting your cash besides putting it in a bank. But our deposits here in America are government guaranteed up to a point. So if the bank goes under, your accounts are insured. But that's what I would recommend. I just love master limited partnerships. I really do. You get the good ones. I mean, you don't get these little squirrely ones. But find out something that's big, substantial, and paying out dividends. Okay.
Great advice. All right. Ann writes, should I spank my child age 4 or do timeouts? She is wonderful, just has outbursts or back talk sometimes.
The Bible says folly is bound up in the heart of a child and the rod of reproof drives it far from them. But you've got a sweet little daughter who really wants very much to do what you want, but she's got something going on inside of her. She's got hormones coming along. She's moving toward puberty, and all of a sudden, she doesn't quite know who
she is.
She's
only 4.
She'll get toward puberty.
Oh. Okay.
I'm not getting a kid in puberty at 4. I know when you get to puberty.
Okay, I'm sorry. Okay.
But those hormones start early, and they keep building up, and so these little rages build up. And I had a beautiful daughter who used to pound her head on the floor. She'd get upset, and she'd literally pound her head. She'd get so frustrated. Sweetest child. I mean, she's now a mother and loves God, and it's beautiful. And I've always said, a teenage girl, there's no way you can reason with them. There's just no way. Okay. What I did with that one child, I decided a cold shower was not a bad thing. So she'd have one of those outbreaks. I'd just take her and shove her under the cold shower.
Ooh, and I guess she started having fewer outbursts.
She did, but I don't know if that helped or not. But the biggest thing you want to do as a parent is graduate your children from you to Jesus. Make sure Jesus is the control. And you say, you ask Jesus what you should do. What does Jesus say? What do you think he would do? And let him be the control. Then she's not fighting you, she's fighting God. And she said, that's not good. I want to serve Jesus. Yeah. But the biggest thing is bring them up with the nurture and admonition of the Lord, not worrying about do I spank them or not spank them. Okay.
All righty. Well, Sylvia writes, I was told fear comes from Satan. So is it wrong to feel scared knowing the end is very near? I feel happy some days and nervous other days. Well, you know, I joined the club, right?
Perfect love casts out fear. Fear has torment. Fear comes from the devil. It doesn't come from God. There's a natural reason to be afraid. If you're standing over a pit and somebody's getting ready to push you in, well, you'll have a sense of fear, like you want to fight to preserve yourself. But these irrational feel, for example, about the end days, I mean, you know, that's in God's hands. Trust the Lord. And rest in him and live your life to the fullest and let him take care of the stuff you can't control. I mean, that's the biggest thing, you know. But fear is not of God. And so you say, I'm scared. You're confessing that you're sinning against God. Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay, Gloria writes, I'm concerned about my spiritual well-being. I was very promiscuous as a teenager and into my early 20s. I had sex with people I did not know, and I had 2 abortions. I have converted to Christianity and am now very dedicated to my faith. I've been having serious life-threatening health issues lately, and I feel as if I'm not prepared to meet my Lord. What can I do to let God know how sorry I am?
What you can do is tell him. You know, you read the Bible, and who was the person who saw Jesus on the day of his resurrection? It was Mary Magdalene, and some thought that Mary Magdalene was a prostitute. She had demon possession, at least we know that, and she was the one chosen to meet the Lord and to hear one of the most precious things that he had to say. Jesus forgives you. You did things that were wrong, and he forgives you, and he doesn't want you beating yourself up. He says he wants our consciences cleansed from dead works that we might serve the living God. So come before him, confess if you want to, make a list. All those guys you had sex with, write a list. Okay, one, if you could, how many are they? I don't know. you said there were a lot of them.
She said there were a lot of them.
All right, name them. I'm sorry, Charlie, Bill, whatever. I'm sorry about the abortions. Forgive me, Lord, and name them and take his forgiveness on every one of them. If not, you need to write out a list and then hold it before the Lord, confess each one, and then tear the thing up or burn it up, and you're free.
Mm. Okay. That's amazing. You know, the enemy just wants to keep her in bondage, but Jesus forgives her.
He wants us free to serve the living God. He wants our service, not, he doesn't want us bowing down our head and beating ourselves up. But there comes a time you say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. You know you're a sinner. You confess your sins, and then you take forgiveness. Mm. And he enfolds you and loves you. That's Amen. The kind of God we serve.
We sure okay. do. Amen. That's beautiful. Well, up next, a woman breaks out in a painful rash, and doctors are helpless to cure it.
I've never seen an allergy like that in my life, where chunks of skin fell off, and then it hit my face. Within 2 or 3 days, my whole face was swollen.
Wow, watch how she's supernaturally healed. Plus, we'll be praying for you, so don't go away.
Children, each of them precious, each of them a gift, each of them unique. All of them are a work in progress, a story being written. A sculpture taking form. That's where Superbook comes in, by providing a strong spiritual foundation for the children you love.
This Easter, Peter's denial.
I am ready to go to prison with you and even to die with you.
A story of betrayal and forgiveness.
Before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny 3 times that you even know me.
Join the Superbook DVD Club and get Superbook's newest episode, Peter's Denial. Plus 2 copies to share with others, all for your gift of $25. And as a bonus, receive 3 copies of Superbook favorite, He Is Risen, just for joining now.
Do you love me more than these?
Yes, Lord.
Then take care of my sheep.
Superbook's latest episode, Peter's Denial, can be yours for a one-time gift of just $25, or you can get it by joining the Superbook DVD Club. It's also just $25. Your credit or debit card will be charged whenever a new DVD is released. And we have a special Easter bonus, too. If you join our Superbook DVD Club by April 30th, you'll receive 3 copies of Peter's Denial and 3 copies of He Is Risen. So you can have some for you and to give away. And if you order by April 11th, we guarantee delivery by Easter. So for more information, just call us 1-800-759-0700, or you can log on to cbn.com. Pretty cool. Peter's Denial. It's our new one.
There's a lady named Honey. Honey's a nice name. Husbands call her wife Honey. Yeah. Wives call her husbands Honey. Well, Honey Smith was in agony. A hideous rash covered Honey's body, burning her and causing large chunks of her skin to fall off. Doctors said, Honey, we can't help you. But after 2 months of suffering, Honey had almost given up hope.
I started getting a rash on my arm, and it got worse and worse. And after a few weeks, it was on both feet, both knees, and started on this arm.
Over time, Honey Smith suffered even more as her rash spread and intensified.
I've never seen an allergy like that in my life, where chunks of skin fell off, and then it hit my face. Within 2 or 3 days, my whole face was swollen. My eyes, I couldn't even open them.
Honey visited several doctors for answers. They decided to treat her for burns and an allergy, but couldn't determine what was causing her rash. Medicine offered no relief for the pain.
I didn't sleep for 2 months, maybe 10 minutes and 15 minutes at a time. I had gotten to the point where I can't deal with this, and my hope was gone. I wasn't praying anymore, I was begging. And I said, God, do something.
In August of 2013, during a painful and sleepless night, Honey was flipping through the channels and landed on the 700 Club.
This was maybe 2:33 in the morning. And just as I switched it, a few seconds later, Pat said,
"There's somebody that's got something all over your face. It's a sort of a weird disease. It's almost like a burn, but it isn't. And it covers your face. Put your hand on your face right now and just wipe your hand across your face. God just healed you, completely restored. Your skin's gonna be like a baby in the name of Jesus."
I pushed the record button. I sat there for the next 4 hours and watched that probably 50 times. The pain diminished and it was bearable. It became bearable for the first time in 2 months. I could just relax. I'm just thanking God and praising God and playing that thing over and over and over.
After that night, the rash healed rapidly.
Within a few days, the swelling was going down, the redness was going away. I've never had a problem with it since. God is still healing. He's still there for us. I had given up hope. There was no hope left in me. And He restored all that and multiplied it. I want to see God do that for everybody, what He did for me. Because He's a good God and He loves us, and I just can't love Him enough back for what He did.
Oh, honey, I agree with you. I didn't know her condition, but the Lord showed me, and it was just so clear. The Lord just dramatic healing. Doctors couldn't do it. Doctors are good. I appreciate the medical profession. I really do. The skill is marvelous. Mm. But Jesus Christ is the great physician. Here's another testimony.
Yeah, another incredible testimony. Yeah. Larry from Azusa, California, had an accident at work in 2011 and injured his shoulder. He had almost constant pain in the shoulder that made it difficult to do his job. Then last January, Larry's wife Amanda got the flu and developed bronchitis as well on top of her existing asthma. One day they were watching the 700 Club and Amanda started having a hard time breathing. They were getting ready to take her to the hospital when Pat and Wendy had words of knowledge. Pat said, "Somebody's got the flu. The Lord is healing you of this influenza. You have tremendous congestion in your lungs. At this moment, cough, and all of a sudden you'll find that your lungs are free and you can breathe freely, and you are set free in the name of Jesus." Then I said, "There are people with asthma, breathing issues, breathing problems all over the country, and Lord, you're just touching people's lungs right now and their sinuses, and you're helping them breathe." And then you said, "Pat, there's a shoulder situation. I'm not sure whether it's the deltoid muscle or the rotator, but whatever it is right now, touch your shoulder. In the name of Jesus, there's fire. You'll feel fire going through that joint, and you are healed in Jesus' name." Immediately, Larry raised his arm, felt a warm tingling and a pop, and the pain was gone. He's had no pain since. Amanda took a deep breath and immediately could breathe normally. This is so cool. Her flu symptoms were gone. The bronchitis was gone. The asthma was gone. She has been breathing normally since that day. And they're both praising the Lord, and I can see why.
Wendy, isn't God good?
So good.
I mean, ladies and gentlemen, I stand in awe of the Lord. We serve a great God. He's a great God, and He's a God who loves you. We're going to join hands. We just got a moment. Father, we pray now for people in this audience. They're crying out to you now. Hear their prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, may the healing power of God touch you in Jesus' name. Touch!
Yes. Thank you, God.
Fire! Wendy, go ahead.
Kidneys. There's some people with very painful kidneys. Just put your hands right now on your back where your kidneys are. The Lord's touching you and healing you right now.
In Jesus' name. Amen. If you need further prayer, give us a call. We're here. The counselors are here, even though we're off the air. We leave you with today's Power Minute from 2 Kings chapter 20. Thus says the Lord, I have heard your prayer. I have seen your tears. Surely I will heal you. Friday, take a look at mind-blowing business of legalized marijuana. Don't want to miss it. See you later.
Just out of the blue, the pain would hit me and I would fall. My arches were falling, and I also had bone spurs, arthritis, and pneumosis, which is an infection of the foot. The 700 Club was on, and it was the last 10 minutes. Gordon Robertson came on.
There's a woman, you're saying, the soles of your feet, you've got problems with fallen arches in both feet. It's very difficult for you to walk, very painful. God's healing you now.
I just had this supernatural knowledge that I was healed. So I stood up and just started jumping up and down like a rabbit, just rejoicing and laughing and crying and
hysterical because the pain was gone. My feet weren't hurting, my legs weren't hurting, my hip wasn't hurting, my back wasn't hurting, and it was so remarkable. God just wanted me to know He was in the business of healing. He did complete what He started.